Good morning. My name is Mindy Epps. I'm the National Product Manager with Graybar, and I'd like to welcome you to Graybar's G2 Talk presentation on how to test 40 gig trunks for hyper data center installs. We have a great presentation lined up for you today, but before we get started, I'm going to do some housekeeping items. First, if you're one of the first 50 people to join, you're going to receive a coupon for a free cup of coffee, courtesy of Graybar. Hopefully that'll help put a little hyper into your data center. At the bottom of your screen, you're going to see a box for Q&A. Feel free to submit questions throughout the presentation. We'll get to as many questions as we can at the end, considering how much time we have left. Lastly, our G2 Talks are all going to be archived on graybar.com's website, so you will be able to view the presentation again or recommend it to others. Today, we are teaming up with Fluke Networks. Graybar works alongside Fluke Networks. You can learn more about this if you visit graybar.com. At this time, I'm going to introduce today's speaker, Carolyn Carter. Carolyn is a certification product manager for Fluke Networks. In this position, she is responsible for certification test tools, typically used by datacom contractors and installers. Carolyn holds a bachelor's degree in computer science from the University of Berkeley, California. She brings over 20 years' experience to the industry, and we're very excited to have her today. Without further delay, I'm going to turn things over to you, Carolyn.
Great. Thank you very much, Mindy. I appreciate the opportunity to conduct this webinar and to talk about testing hyper data centers. So with that, let me talk about the agenda. When you're testing 40 gig hyper data centers, you're typically going to be using MPO links or trunks. So today I'm going to talk about how you actually test those MPO trunks. I'm going to start talking first of all about the standards that are involved, then typically how most of these MPO trunks are being tested, or I like to say were tested in the past using an optical loss test set. That there has to be a better way because the old way of doing it was very complicated and time consuming. So I'm going to show you a better way and the new way to be testing MPO trunks. We're going to talk about setting a reference because whenever you're making a loss measurement, reference is very important and you need to make sure you're doing it correctly with MPO. Polarity, there's a lot of different polarities in MPO, so we're going to talk about polarity and how you know which type of polarity you're using at this particular time in a trunk. We're going to talk about referencing with polarity and how you test it because, again, polarity, because there's multiple different versions of it, really matters in your testing. If you have the wrong polarity, then your test results will be invalid. And then I'm going to show you actually how to test MPO trunks with the Fluke Network solution called MultiFiber Pro. So with that, let's go ahead and jump in. But as they said before, there should probably going to be questions. Please go ahead and answer the ask questions in the Q&A because I really like to have interaction. And if I see a question coming up a lot, I may just go ahead and address it during the presentation itself. So with that, let's talk about the standards. In particular, I'm going to be looking at the ANSI TIA 568C.0. And with any loss test, there's two different types of testing out there in the standards. The first one is called Tier 1, and it is definitely required. It's basically a loss test. So for each of the optical links, you need to measure the attenuation loss with an OLTS or a power meter light source. You also need to verify the length with that, and you can do that when you're using an OLTS. Or if you're using a power meter light source, you're going to have to know and calculate the limit yourself. Tier 1 is always required. Tier 2 is optional. And what Tier 2 is it's the Tier 1 loss test plus an OTDR characterization of the link. So you need to understand what you're being asked for, or if you're the customer, the end user, what you require. You always will want Tier 1, but you may or may not want Tier 2. Then there's something called launch conditions for an optical loss test. And that basically is describing what the power is at the end of the test cord. And these standards require that this be in circle flux compliant. So you need to make sure that you're using a circle flux compliant test gear when you're doing a optical loss test. Okay, so with that, let's go ahead and talk about how optical or how MPO trunks have been tested in the past using an OLTS or an optical loss test set. So typically, you would have to set a reference. This I'm showing is a one jumper reference, but that's not the only reference that you would have to set. You would typically have to set a three jumper reference. So I'm describing the characteristics of the one jumper reference, which is fairly easy to do. It gets a little more complicated, as you can see, when now you have to do a second or a three jumper reference. So there's different areas and mistakes that can be made if you're not doing this correctly. So if you are using an optical loss test set to test MPOs, make sure that you set the three jumper reference correct, because if you don't get this right, then your test results will not be valid. So there, a copy of this presentation with these different instructions is going to be available.
Sorry, everybody. We have a temporary loss of audio. We're going to get Carolyn back on the line. Please be patient. Thank you.
Hi, sorry, this is Carolyn. Not sure what happened there. Just want to do an audio check. Do you have me back?
Yes. Thank you, Carolyn. Yes, we can all hear you.
No problem. Sorry about that. So as I was talking about setting the reference, the presentation will be available at the end, so you can go through the steps. Just make sure you set a reference correctly. So once you set the reference, then you have to now connect your optical loss test set, which is a single fiber tester, to a fan-out cable so you can connect to the MPO trunk. And you will need a fan-out cable on both ends. Some people call them breakout cable, hydra cables. They're all the same thing. It's a way to take the 12-pin MPO to 12 individual LCs. So you're going to connect like this with a fan-out cable on both sides. And you're going to then connect to the first fiber in the trunk. So you're going to, first two actually, you're going to connect to the first two and you're going to run a test. In this case, we have passed on strands one and two. We're now going to move to the next pair. And again, we have a pass on three and four. Continue down the whole trunk. We pass on five and six. We pass on seven and eight. You can see this is tedious. We pass on 9 and 10, but oh darn, we have a failure on 11 and 12. So we have an issue with the link. What do we have to do? So let's now look at testing notes. What do you do if you fail? Well, the first thing you do is you hope that the problem is on the LC point of view. So you want to clean the LC connections that were involved, and you want to retest. If it passes when you after the retest, you're good, you can save the results and continue on. The problem is, if it doesn't pass and now you have to clean the MPO connections, you now need to start back at the top of that MPO trunk and retest all 12 links because you disconnected the MPO. So this can be quite tedious. Cleaning is very, very important, so you want to make sure everything is clean on both the LC side and the MPO side to do this. Also, polarity. You have to determine the polarity and write down what the reference is for each and every fiber. And if it changes, you have to deal with that. Fan-out jumpers, they're very expensive. They typically cost about four times the price of a single test reference cord. And just like a TRC or a test reference cord, they are consumable. They are going to wear out. You need to make sure that both your TRCs, the single-strand TRCs, and your fan-out cables or breakout cables are good and valid, and if not, replace them. So it's a lot more difficult to test this way, and it's very, very time-consuming. So a better way was needed because people were saying it was taking too long. Instead of having to test each and every link or strand by itself, we wanted a tester that had many sources and many power meters, and in the case of MPO, 12 sources and 12 power meters. So Fluke Networks introduced a product called MultiFiber Pro. We are the first tester to be able to support both single mode and multi-mode MPO fiber testing. We have three sources available, 850 for multi-mode, 1310 and 1550 for single mode. So even though these products look small, they're really powerful because the power meter actually has 12 power meter interfaces inside of it, individual power meters, and the sources have 12 individual sources in them. So there's a lot of stuff packed in that box. MultiFiber Pro is Encircle Flux compliant at the bulkhead. We measure and report polarity a little differently than everybody else. So I can tell you what polarity is. You don't have to configure my polarity like you do on a lot of other testers. MultiFiber Pro will also automatically detect and analyze all kinds of different fiber lengths, whether you're using a fiber trunk that has 12 lit fibers or 8 or 10. We can automatically determine what type of fiber system you're using and pass and fail correctly. So if you're using something like one of these new 8 fiber links where the four middle fibers are dead or not there, we won't fail you on those four dead fibers. We will only pass and fail you on the 8 fibers, the four on each edge, that are actually live. And MultiFiber Pro works with Linkware Live PC, which is the de facto standard cabling certification software program for reporting. And we work on that. We have a really nice wizard that allows you to take the data off of MultiFiber Pro and get it into Linkware PC. So I want to give you a real quick understanding of how the results work. It has a bar graph on it with 8 ovals, and if you're doing a power measurement, the ovals will show you how much power you are actually getting. There also is a display for each for an individual channel, so you can get an alphanumeric display also. You have a bar graph for each of the 12, so you can see the results of all 12 at once, or an alphanumeric or a numerical version of the result for an individual channel. We also have a power measurement or a loss measurement for the bar graph. And in this case, you're going to be looking at the ovals. There will be 5 ovals in a line. If all 5 ovals, so one of them is above that limit line, is there, that is a failure. In this case, for a loss measurement, you want the fewer ovals, the better. So like if you see a single oval or 2 ovals, you're far under the limit line, and that is the best case. But again, there's a bar graph, so you can see the results of all 12 fibers at one time, or you can see the results numerically for one fiber. As I was saying, we support both single mode and multi-mode, and MultiFiber has MultiFiber Pro has a unique power meter port. We knew that single mode was going to be coming out, So when this was designed, it was designed to handle both a multi-mode TRC or a single-mode TRC. So we utilize a non-contact area import port on the power meter. And you can see this is what it will look like graphically. Inside, we have a flat connector for a multi-mode TRC, and this is our input and then our large core. So when a TRC mates with us, as you can see here, the multi-mode TRC will mate on this flat surface, and we have this large non-contact interface where we can actually take the measurement. Now, if you're using single mode, again, we have the same power meter, so we have the same power meter port, but within a single mode APC connector or TRC mates with us, it's angle polished. So it has about a 7-degree angle. That will now mate on this angled surface. So MultiFiber Pro is the only power meter that can handle both a multi-mode, where it is a flat or a UPC connection, and a single mode APC connection. So we can handle either one. We are ready for both multi-mode and single mode. As I was saying before, there is a lot of different polarity in a MPO trunk system. So you need to know the polarity, because the purpose of polarity is to make sure that the network is up and that you can have transmit to receive. And so a properly configured link is going to be type B, and I'm going to show you the types in a minute from end to end. And type B is straight through. However, in an MPO system, polarity can change. So you may be type B in one case, you may be type A in another case, you may be type C in another case, or there's even a fourth polarity. And the polarity is not consistent throughout the system. So let's talk about the different types of polarity. As I said, type B is a straight through, but there's also something called type A, where you have a flip. So in this case, they are flipped, and on one side, one would be at the top fiber, and at the other side, 12 would be the top fiber. So the fibers are flipped. In type C, individual pairs are flipped. So because of this, you need to make sure that your polarity from end to end is B straight through, but the polarity can change throughout the system. So you need to understand what type of polarity you are. So if you need to make a measurement in the middle of the system, you can make the measurement correctly. Because if you are trying to measure a type A polarity and you're configured for type B, your results will not be correct. So that's three of the four polarities. The fourth polarity is what we call universal. And this polarity system is Corning's. It's their Corning plug-and-play universal system polarity management. And you can see it's a little different, and you can see there's this graphical representation. On MultiFiber Pro, we show this polarity as universal. One really nice thing about MultiFiber Pro is you don't have to configure the polarity for it. MultiFiber Pro can tell you what the polarity is no matter where you plug in to the system. We can figure it out and tell you which polarity it is. You do not need to configure polarity on MultiFiber Pro. But because polarity can change, as I said, you might be polarity B in one area of the system and polarity A in another, there needs to be agnostics referencing for testing. So what do I mean for that? Well, again, an MPO deployment can have different polarities. So therefore, a source channel may be referenced in one case by, in this case, maybe source channel 1 may be referenced by meter channel 2. However, if a polarity changes, that same source channel may now be measured by a different meter channel, like 1. So if I changed from polarity B to polarity A, I'm now measuring on a different channel. So because of this, you need to make sure that the meter can transfer these references from channel to channel when a polarity change occurs. So that's kind of confusing. So let me give it to you, let me show it to you graphically. This will probably make it simpler. So right now I have a polarity type B system, and I have set references. So on fiber 1, I have the reference 24.01. On fiber 2, I have the reference 24.02, all the way down to fiber 12, where I have the reference 24.12. Okay, that's polarity B. Let's say that the polarity changes, and I now go to polarity A. Well, that means that my fibers are going to change also. And since my fibers flipped, I also now need to change my referencing. So MultiFiber Pro knows the polarity changed and knows that the references now need to change and will automatically go through all the references and change them accordingly. So since we went from B to A, that means the references need to flip. So now when this is done, now on channel 1 or on fiber 1, the reference is 24.12. I have flipped the references. So MultiFiber Pro understands this and will automatically change the references for you as your polarity changes in the system. And the way it does this is through polarity agnostic referencing. The power meter or the MultiFiber Pro can correctly transfer these references since it's using a large non-contact interface, and we have encoded a channel ID inside of MultiFiber Pro. So it knows how it was referenced, it knows what polarity it was referenced with, and if the polarity changes, it knows how to change or move the references around so it still has the proper configuration and can provide the proper results. That's very, very important to understand. You need to understand the polarity you were using when you set reference, and then what happens to all of these references if you change change polarity. So if you're testing MPO, make sure you understand about polarity. So now I want to walk you through how I actually can test an MPO trunk with MultiFiber Pro. There's multiple types of MPO trunks, and I'm going to walk you through two different ones. We're going to start with untinned to an unpinned trunk. But before I go into too much detail, I want to cover some housekeeping stuff. The first thing, and this is important whether you're cleaning a single-strand system or an MPO system, but it is very important for MPO, is that you clean. Anytime you touch fiber, before you reconnect the fiber, you need to make sure you clean both ends of that. So if it is a patch cord being connected to another patch cord or another fiber and it's through an adapter, you need to make sure you clean both ends of those cords, so both end faces. If you're going to be plugging into like a cassette or a patch panel, you want to make sure you clean the in face of the TRC and you clean the port itself, both sides, because if you only clean one and the other one is dirty, transference can occur and you can transfer the dirt to the other in face, and if there is a piece of dirt or debris, it could scratch or damage one of the in faces. Dirt is still the number one cause of fiber network failure because people don't always clean it, things get dirty. Dust caps do not keep in faces clean. All they do is protect them from being damaged, from being like scratched or from being pitted. And as soon as you put a dust cap on, you're basically dirtying that in face. So you need to make sure you clean. Since MPO trunks, or MPO, is 12 fibers in an array, cleaning is even more important for MPO systems. And the reason for that is when you clean, you may not be just cleaning it off the one fiber, it may just move it from one fiber to another fiber. So with MPO, it is mandatory that you clean, and we highly recommend that you inspect. Because since you can maybe just transfer the dirt from one fiber to another fiber in the array, you want to make sure that whole array is clean because it only takes one bad strand to fail your entire trunk. So the moral of the story is when you're doing MPO testing, clean before every test, clean both sides, and honestly, myself, I would inspect. So once you have a clean fiber, now you need to prepare the meter for testing. So right now, all MPO is tested through a power meter light source, so you need to set and determine what your limit line would be. So there's two ways of determining the limit. There's test limits that are provided by different manufacturers. In this example, I'm using Corning, the Premium Edge 8 system, and so these are their limits that you would use to, or their test limits, and so you'd figure out based on the length of the cabling that you're installing what type of limit that you would set in the meter. So you can use the cable manufacturing's limits, or you can use application-based limits. Either one can be used. MultiFiber Pro allows you to set that limit, so it provides the pass-fail analysis for you. So once you have your limit, you go in and you put it into the MultiFiber Pro unit and set your reference, and then you're ready to go. So let's talk about setting your reference. Even though we're now talking about an MPO trunk, which has, again, the array of 12 fibers, setting a reference here is no different than setting a reference on a normal single-strand tester. So we're going to start. We're going to hook up a test cord between the power meter and the source. And in this case, this test cord for MultiFiber Pro would be pinned to pinned because MultiFiber Pro is an unpinned tester. All right? So you would set that up just like that. And then and you'd set your reference. To take the measurement, you're going to disconnect from the meter side. Again, you never disconnect from the source side. Whether it's a single-strand tester or an MPO tester like MultiFiber Pro, you never want to disconnect the TRC from the source side. If you disconnect from the source side, the reference you just set is invalid, and then you'd have to reset the reference again. So to take the measurement after I've set the reference, disconnect from the meter and insert a known good cord into the meter side like we have. So in this case, you're going to have pin to pin on both sides. You are now going to connect to your trunk. If you're going to be connecting to a trunk that is a type A fiber trunk, then you're going to need a type A connector. And the fiber trunk in this case is unpinned to unpinned. So you'd be using a type A connector that is a key down and a key up, as you can see here. Okay? But let's say you're going to connect to a type B fiber link. Okay? Again, it's a pin to unpin connection, but in this case, your connector is going to be key up to key up. Okay? The third one is a type C fiber link. Again, we're pinned to unpinned. And again, you're going to be using a type A adapter, which is a key down and a key up adapter. So you can see, again, here's polarity. What type of polarity are you going into? The types of polarity being used will also determine what type of adapters and the key up, key down that you're using. All right? So that's how I take a measurement on a pin-to-pin or unpin-to-unpin system. Let's take a look if we now have a pinned to a pin trunk. In this case, it's going to look something like this. We're typically using a conversion module that are pinned. In this case, we're using a Corning system as an example. So it has a pin-to-pin conversion module. So I'm going to start, like I did before, setting a one-jumper reference. But because I'm going to a pin-to-pin system, I'm going to need to set a two-jumper reference, and I'm going to show you how to do that. We start by setting the one-jumper reference, just like we did before, where we have a type B cord, which is pin-to-pin. We're then going to disconnect from the meter. We are going to insert a known good pin-to-unpin cord into the meter. So now I have one side that is unpinned to pin, so I can plug into the pin side of the trunk. But on the other side of the meter, I have a pinned sort, but I have a pinned. Oh, sorry, wrong one. So I have an unpinned. So now I'm going to connect these two, and I'm going to run a test and make sure that that cord is good, okay? And I want to make sure that cord's good and it has a loss that is less than 0.35 dB. Again, if it's not good, I need to clean both ends of the cord that is attached to the meter and retest to achieve the result. If it's not, if I can't find a cord that is good, I need to replace that cord and try again until I get one that has a good loss so I know it's a good cord. So now I set the reference, okay? So I now set a reference and I have a two jumper reference at this point. But now when I disconnect, you're gonna see that I have one side that is pinned and one side that is unpinned. That won't work because both sides need to be unpinned to actually connect to my pinned system. So what I need to do is I need to insert another jumper, and this jumper is going to be unpinned to unpinned. Unfortunately, I don't have a way to verify this because of some gender incompatibility. So basically what we say is when you take your first limit or your first measurement, if the losses are high, exchange that jumper because that jumper could be the problem and it may not be the link itself. Another thing you can do is there's now some new MPO TRCs or cords available on the market. They're called gender neutral cords. These cords will allow you to change the pinout of the cord itself, so you can change from pinned to unpinned, and it will also let you change the key up, key down. So maybe if I need a jumper that is pinned and key up, you can actually change the gender of the pin. So if you're using those type of cords, then you wouldn't need to add this third jumper in. You could just change the gender of the cord and continue. So that does make it easier. So now that I've placed the third unpinned cord in, I now can connect to the system under test, and in this case, this Corning conversion module, and then go ahead and test as normal. And then when I'm testing like this, I'm testing all 12 fibers at once, or if it's an 8-pin system, the eight fibers in that system. So I know that's a little complex, especially when I'm going to a pin-to-pin system and I have to use that third cord. So we have written a number of step-by-step knowledge-based articles that lead you through this. The first one is certifying a pin MPO multimode link with MultiFiber Pro, and I'm calling this method one. That method is using the gender-neutral cords. So if you'd like to understand how to do it with a gender-neutral cords, use that one. The second one is method two, and that is using the standard type of cords that come with MultiFiber Pro, and in this case, you are going to have to add that third cord in. Then I have one to how do you actually do it if it is an unpinned trunk with MultiFiber Pro. Again, those are step-by-step instructions. Or if you're using a cassette that takes a trunk, an MPO trunk, to individual LC links, I have two different ways of doing that, and there's two different articles there to help you. So this tries to help you with step-by-step instructions so you get it right. The nice thing about using an MPO tester is it saves you about 95% of the time it would take you to do these type of tests with a regular single-strand test setup. So you just need to go through the procedure. Once you do it a couple times, it's simple, and it's very step-by-step, and MultiFiber Pro will save you a lot of time on an MPO-type system to test these MPO links for your 40 and 100-gig systems. Will save you lots and lots of time. So with that, I think we're going to open it up to questions, and I will let Mindy come back.
Yeah, thanks, Carolyn. To Carolyn's point, we're going to roll over and start taking some questions. But just as a reminder, you can still submit questions at the bottom of your screen using the Q&A box. If you would like a copy of the data sheet on the MultiFiber Pro, you can just type data sheet into the questions, and we'll be sure to have a Graybar representative follow up and provide that to you. All right, so there's a couple questions around cleaning, so I'll go ahead and try and combine some of these if we can. One of them says, shouldn't you visually check if it's clean before you clean? And what types of tools or what would you need to ensure that you're cleaning properly?
Great question. That's a good question on, do you visually inspect before you clean or not? It really depends on the philosophy that you're using. Some people say that you should visually inspect before you clean. Others say that's just time and you don't need to do that. I like to basically say you always clean. I like to say you clean, then you inspect. There's a lot of people who will clean and go ahead and run the test. If it fails, then they come out and they do inspect. But in MPO, you may want to inspect first because cleaning can just move dirt. And what you would use to actually inspect an MPO is something like Versive camera, the FI-1000. It is a video microscope that has four different MPO tips available. We have tips that can look at a single row of fibers. So if you have like a 1x12, we can look across that whole row of 12. Or if you're looking at something like a 24-pin MPO, then we have another converter for multimode that allows you to look across the row and then look horizontal or vertically between the rows. So we call that an X and Y tip. So it lets you look up and down between the rows and horizontally across any of the rows. So those are UPC for multimode. If you're using a single mode system, in an MPO system, single mode is always APC. So I also have a single row APC tip or a XY APC tip, so you can go up and down the rows or vertically across. So to inspect MPO, again, you're going to need a special tip that can look across the whole array of MPO fibers. And you would be using a click-type cleaner, such as the one shown here, to clean those that array. But I really do suggest you use some type of inspection to make sure that you are cleaning and you have fully removed the dirt from all the different fibers instead of just moving it from one fiber to another. Because if one of the strands goes down, then you do have to retest across everything. And cleaning is really important and the biggest problem when it comes to MPO. So let's see.
All right. Okay, next question is, can you use a converter adapter that has an MPO in and an LC out?
Great question. So let's see. Let me go back to one. That would be typically either a breakout cable or something like this, where it is a converter module. Oh, not that one, sorry. Do I not have a picture of a converter module? No, I guess I don't. So there's converter modules where you might have one MPO coming in and 12 LC links coming out. So yes, you can use something like that. And in that case, then you would be testing a single strand and you'd be using like an OLTS. If you're saying the other way, you have 12 individual strands and you want to test it with an MPO, so you're going to be linking into the 12 strands and you want to test on the MPO trunk, yeah, you could do it that way. I really, typically it's the other way, but yes. So in that case, where's my breakout cord? I thought I have a breakout cord in here. It would be in the very beginning. Just a second, I'm trying to get to it. So you'd be using a breakout cord, something like this. So typically, you would be taking the MPO here and testing with an OLTS if you're going that way. If you're trying to come this way, I haven't heard of a lot of people to do it, but yeah, you could do it.
Okay.
Not sure if that answered the question or not.
I certainly hope so. The next one kind of circles back a little bit to cleaning, and it says, do you use the test function on the camera for inspection, or do you just check to see that it's clean before running the certifier?
Well, it depends on, for Fluke Networks, we have, our camera works with the Versa platform, and it's called the FI7000, and at this point, we don't have certification for MPO. We only have certification for a single strand. I don't know of any tester out there that actually can certify and can inspect and certify an MPO link. So you would be doing manual visual inspection. Another question here is, does Fluke support the use of third-party TRCs? So yes, you can. For MultiFiber Pro, yes. For other equipment, that's a different story, depending on if it's in circle flux. But in this case in point, if we're looking at these breakout cables and you do need breakout cables, or let's say you're testing a 24-pin MPO link and you want to test that with MultiFiber Pro. Well, MultiFiber Pro can't test 24 links. You need to break that 24-pin MPO out into two or three additional links. And to do that, you would need a breakout cable created. What we suggest is when you have that breakout cable connected or created, you go back to your cable manufacturer and you have that breakout cable created using the same fiber as the fiber in your system under test. When you have that breakout cable created, you also need to understand the polarity and what type of polarity you need on each end of that cable. So it's really important that you work with your cable manufacturer when you need to create different cords, such as these breakout cables. So it's really important you work with your cable manufacturer to make sure that you have the right type of cord created using the fiber that is in your system, plus it has the correct polarity. So let's see, I'm just walking through some of these. Lots of data sheets, this is great. I think I already answered the one about the converter. Sorry, I'm going through and looking for some. We talked about the cleaning. Oh, here's a good one. Does the length of strands under test need to be entered manually to create the budget? Yes, to create the budget, since MultiFiber Pro is a power meter light source, it is not an OLTS, we don't automatically create the limit or the budget for you. You as the user will need to create the budget yourself, and to do that, you will need to know the length of the fiber. In an MPO world, that typically is not an issue because your MPO links are created for you and you are pre-terminated, and you know the length of those links. So you can go look at the length of the fiber that you're installing, and using that length, you then can calculate the correct budget.
All right, so another one I see is, what is the total loss allowance for MPO with LC module?
That really is going to depend on the products that you're using, and you need to really talk to the manufacturer of the equipment you're using, because the standards will say one thing, and the
a cable manufacturer may have different limits that they want. So we always recommend that you talk to your cable manufacturing, especially for things like warranty, for what type of limits they require. And then if they have different types of limits than is in the standard, and that's what they want for the warranty, that is what you use. So we recommend that you go back to your cable manufacturing to completely understand what is required.
All right, Carolyn, we're just out of time at this point. So if we didn't get to your question, we apologize. A Graybar representative can follow up with you after our call. As a reminder, this presentation has been recorded, and we're going to throw that out onto the graybar.web.com website so that you guys can access it when we're done. Again, thank you so much for your time today, and we'll hope you will join us again on our next G2 Talk.
Great. Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to make this presentation, and thank you very much for joining. Have a great day.